This is a dance for the river. It calls on our ancestors to put the spirit back into the land and into the water and heal it. My name's Tyrone, and I'm Ngarrindjeri. For tens of thousands of years, my people have lived at the Kurong, where the river meets the sea. We call it Murrindi, and you know it as the Murray. But Ngarrindjeri people, like my grandfather, have seen the river change.
And we got in the boat, and you'd be able to see the fish swimming into the nets. The Kurong was like looking through clear water. You can't see them now. The water was changing a different colour. You know, everything was getting bad. The fish were dying, the birds, the river, the lakes, the Kurong. It was dying.
And that's why we dance with the river. Because it's not just important to us, it's important to all Australians. Come with me and I'll take you on a journey along Australia's longest and most developed river. We'll meet some of the kids that live along it and depend on it for all different reasons, and find out why we all need to work together to heal the Murray.
My name is Jock McKenzie, I'm 15 years old and I live in Manangatang. I've been fishing in the Murray River for as long as I can remember. My dad used to bring me down when I was little all the time, every weekend, and I loved it. My dad is a professional fishing and photography journalist.
And he goes. What a beauty. What an absolute ripper.
He travels around some of Australia catching giant Murray cod and obviously photographing them, writing about them for magazines and newspapers. Murray River cod are a big, green, slimy fish. They're one of the largest growing fish that's in the Murray River. They're the greatest fish, in all honesty. I can't think of any other fish I'd rather catch. It gives you the adrenaline rush, they're good fun. But when we catch giant Murray cod, we release them so that they can grow and repopulate the river.
Drop the big fella back to drink.
Threats that cod face are being overpopulated by carp and redfin, so introduced species. The carp are a really big problem in the river. You can eat carp, but they taste like mud, because that's basically, they bury themselves in the mud, and yes, they taste like mud. The fact that we keep dropping and rising the river and removing snags is another big one, because that's where they live and where they breed. Snags are basically when a tree falls in the river, and when they've been in the river for a long time, all the leaves and stuff will blow off it, and that's where the cod live. They live in between the snags. I think in future years, cod are going to come back in an increased number as more rules are being set. The river, to me, it's home. I'd rather be here than at home. This is my home. I'll be fishing forever.
Aboriginal people fished the river from canoes they made from the bark of the red gum trees. If you travel along the river, you can still see canoe trees. Some of them are hundreds of years old. There are also reminders of the river's more recent history, when riverboats turned the water into a highway and reshaped inland Australia.
I'm Jackson and I'm a deckhand on the PS industry. Well, I've been interested in the industry for and all paddle steamers on the Murray River since I was about 3 years old, when we'd come down here to feed the ducks. So I wasn't interested in the ducks, just the PS industry.
Well, I don't know, you don't find too many kids that are interested in paddle boats. There's a few kids at my school that are fairly interested, but most of them think it's pretty good.
Technically, we should stay on his starboard, and we'll give one long toot to warn him, and it's in a short one for starboard that we're going to pass on that side when we get closer.
know, the riverboats helped open up inland Australia. They'd carry wheat and wool and general items that people would use along the river from the stations and also back up to the stations and everything. In the 1920s they built the railways and road transport became more viable to everyone. These days they're used mostly for tourism.
I don't know, I just like paddle steamers. Yeah, I want to be a shipwright, captain, engineer at the Port of Echuca when I grow up.
I think I'll be interested in paddle steamers till I die.
The locks and the weirs along the river were built for the paddle boats to make sure the river was always deep enough to travel through. And they still operate today.
My name's Kathy and I live at Redmarket Lock 5 with my mum, dad and my three brothers.
Stand up in barge, still in the water.
I like living near the river because I get to wake up and see the river every morning. My papa was a lock master at Lock 5, and then my dad came a lock master after him.
Right, so here we go, Case. I'll start it up.
A lock master's job involves letting boats run up and down the river and helping the river run.
Nice clean water, isn't it?
A boat enters the lock and the gates close behind them. It takes about 5 minutes for the water to lower to the same level as the water downstream.
So what I'm doing now, Case, is I'm actually opening the valves. You'll see the water start to come out. See it? Here it comes. Look at that. Plenty of water coming out. So that's 4 million litres of water, Casey. 5.5 minutes.
The locks were built in the 1920s. In the old days, they didn't worry about the effect that it was having on the environment. But now they do, so they let extra water flow through. The fish need to swim upstream to have babies, but when the weir came, they couldn't swim upstream anymore. So they needed to have a fishway so they could swim upstream and have babies. I'm proud of the work that my dad does for the river.
European settlers changed the river so they can use it as transport and for farming. They built irrigation pipes and channels to take the water to the towns and to farms like this one.
I'm Latara Trigg.
And I'm Brooklyn Trigg.
And we are on a vineyard farm. We grow dried grapes. It gets pretty dry in summer, so that's why we use water to irrigate.
Most farmers around here use irrigation.
It comes from the Murray River, and you have to pay for the water because if we take too much, we might end up in a drought again.
We use drip irrigation. We used to use flood irrigation, except we've stopped now because it's wasting a lot more water, and the water that does get wasted goes into the lakes.
It can sometimes make blue and green algae, which is very poisonous to like fish and all the creatures in there.
Now, what we used to have to do, we had to come here once a week when we had flood irrigation, and we'd have to turn it on like that by hand. And it used to just wash through here. And it used to take all of our fertiliser all the way down here and there would be none left here. And it would evaporate into the sky and cause greenhouse gases. But what we do now, it's all computerised and we have the drip irrigation system. So what we do is we turn the water on by the computer and it comes out this little hole here and it goes straight to the plant's core and they grow much quicker and get much better crops than we used to. 40% of the food grown in Australia comes from the Murray-Darling Basin, and that's why irrigation is so important, because if we didn't have irrigation, then the Murray-Darling Basin wouldn't be irrigated and wouldn't have that much water to water their plants, to grow food, to grow to Australia.
It's everyone's job to look after the river because it's for everyone to enjoy.
People are starting to realise that they can't just take what they want from the river. So part of that's understanding more about how it works. And that's what these guys are doing.
This is Wonga Wetlands, and the whole area is recycled water, and it stretches over a huge amount of area and down onto the river.
So what I'll get you guys to do, grab each end of the net, and what we want to do is bring them together. And the idea is to get this end of the net out of the water, so fish won't escape.
Year 11 students from all over the Murray-Darling Basin come together to learn about freshwater ecology and freshwater research. It looks about 4 centimetres.
Yep. From catching the fish, we can tell how many native population there are in the lagoon. This helps to tell us how many exotic versus native fish there are. So generally, the exotic fish are a lot more resistant to harsher water conditions, so the more native, the better the water quality.
Okay, so we're going to use our sweep net, and we're going to try and dislodge any macroinvertebrates that are living on this habitat. And the way you do it is you get in there and bash around very vigorously, and then you sweep through the water and collect up any macroinvertebrates that have been dislodged.
I think it's very important for everyone to learn about the science of the river, because it's our environment and we're going to have to look after it, because everything we do affects the environment and the river.
It's good for us to learn about it, because it'll be here for us, and we need to look after it, the birds, the wetlands, the river.
Right along the river, people are working together to heal it.
Hello, I'm Bella.
And I'm Pippa, and this is Galatea.
Our grandparents bought this property in 1979,
and they moved here from Holland, and they were looking for a rural property, preferably one that was near water. This is a grevillea that Pop has propagated. It's one of the 2,000 that he's done this year. And they also created dams and even a wetlands area to attract other water birds. There's a lot of different birds, 150 different species of birds pass over the area throughout the year. And at the beginning, when they first got this place, there was barely any.
Hey, what's that bird over there?
The white one, see, with the black feathers on top?
Yeah, see, look at this, Pippa. It looks, does that match up?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, but it's an egret then.
Well, the connection with the river is, so the water that feeds the river comes through here.
This is Placid Lagoon.
Yeah, so when the weir comes up, the weir joins this Placid Lagoon and fills it up. And then when it goes down like it is now, it just leaves this, which is a good refuge for all the water birds and stuff when there's no weir. Yeah, it's great because we can just go down there in summer and go for a swim and cool down, or go for a paddle. And
it's also nice sometimes because we have a bonfire or a campfire and we just cook potatoes and they're really yum. I think that what they've done is a really good lesson for Australians, because really they're not even from here. They could have done this in Holland if they'd wanted to, but they decided to do it here. It's everyone's job to look after the river. If we don't look after the river, then we won't be able to drink, we won't be able to eat, we won't be able to wash, we won't have animals to eat. We won't really be able to do anything without water.
For some people, the river's about family. Or fun. For some, it's a passion. Or a livelihood. But it's important for everyone.
If you live in this country now, you have to change your way of how you live, of how you treat the waters, how you treat the land, because this earth is not going to last that long if we don't change.
For Australia, the river's like the blood in our veins. It brings us together and it brings us life. And that's why we need to share it in the good times and in the bad.